there was, I came to see, no one accepted or canonical version of this movement. But the more I read about it, and the more I came to understand the views of its adherents, the more I understood it as resting on a mechanistic view of human life, a view that human beings were devices, and that it was our duty and our destiny to become better versions of the devices that we were, more efficient, more powerful, more useful. I wanted to know what it meant to think of yourself, and more broadly, your species, in such instrumentalist terms. And I wanted to know more specific things. I wanted to know, for instance, how you might go about becoming a cyborg. I wanted to know how you might upload your mind into a computer or some other hardware, with the aim of existing eternally as code. I wanted to know what it would mean to think of yourself as no more or less than a complex pattern of information, as no more or less than code. I wanted to learn what robots might disclose about our understanding of ourselves and our bodies. I wanted to know how likely artificial intelligence was to redeem or annihilate our species. I wanted to know what it might be like to have faith in technology sufficient to allow a belief in the prospect of your own immortality. I wanted to learn what it meant to be a machine, or to think of yourself as such. And I did, I assure you, arrive at some answers to these questions along the way. But in investigating what it meant to be a machine, I must tell you that I also wound up substantially more confused than I already was about what it meant to be a human being. More goal-oriented readers should be advised, therefore, that this book is as much an investigation of that confusion as it is an analysis of those learnings. A broad definition. Transhumanism is a liberation movement advocating nothing less than a total emancipation from biology itself. There is another way of seeing this, an equal and opposite interpretation, which is that this apparent liberation would, in reality, be nothing less than a final and total enslavement to technology. We will be bearing both sides of this dichotomy in mind as we proceed. For all the extremity of transhumanism's aims, the convergence of technology and flesh, for instance, or the uploading of minds into machines, the above dichotomy seemed to me to express something fundamental about the particular time in which we find ourselves, in which we are regularly called upon to consider how technology is changing everything for the better, to acknowledge the extent to which a particular app or platform or device is making the world a better place. If we have hope for the future, if we think of ourselves as having such a thing as a future, it is predicated in large part on what we might accomplish through our machines. In this sense, transhumanism is an intensification of a tendency already inherent in much of what we think of as mainstream culture, in what we may as well go ahead and call capitalism.
Thank you, Mark O'Connell. Please take a seat and return. Tonight we will discuss with writer Hannah Barefoot's, Mark O'Connell and Martijntje Smits, our transhuman future, in part spurred by O'Connell's best-selling To Be a Machine, we just heard a fragment from, and Barefoot's novel, Ivanov. O'Connell explores the roots, ethics, and future of transhumanism in this book, and this is a movement, as we've just heard, that wishes to expand natural borders of human existence with the help of technology. According to others, it's an objectionable philosophy. Also joining the conversation is engineer and innovation philosopher Martijntje Smits. I'll turn you here. We're talking about transhumanism, and I'm not sure how much everyone knows about it. So what is it? Is it a broad movement? Is it a fringe movement? Is it?
Yeah, it's kind of both, actually. I mean, the movement that I write about, I concentrate very specifically in the book on people who are explicitly members of the social movement, transhumanism, and who go to meetings and who describe themselves as transhumanists and so on. And these people believe that we can and should use technology to kind of push out the boundaries of the human condition through doing things like merging ourselves with artificial intelligence and, you know, becoming immortal. And those people are very extreme in what they believe. And they're you know, a relatively small but growing sort of movement of people. But what I found really quickly when I started doing the reporting for the book and looking into this whole movement is that once you start talking to people about transhumanism, you very quickly find that there are lots of people who would not necessarily identify as transhumanist, but who hold some version of these beliefs about the future of humanity. And that similarly, I mean, transhumanism is very focused on Silicon Valley. There's certainly the sort of movement that I investigated for the book is largely kind of, its home is Silicon Valley, and its roots are very deep in the soil of Silicon Valley's kind of culture of techno-optimism and so on. And so there are lots of people in Silicon Valley, very powerful and influential people, people like Peter Thiel and Elon Musk, who do not like explicitly call themselves transhumanists, but their vision of the future is essentially a transcendence of the human body and sort of a merger with artificial intelligence.
So they invest money to become particularly immortal through technology.
Yeah, I mean, both of those people have invested huge amounts of money in the technologies that I write about for the book. So it is, in a way, it's quite a fringe and extreme movement, but its influence is quite deep in Silicon Valley, and there are, you know, very powerful and influential people who are invested in this version of the future. My first kind of, the first time I ever heard about transhumanism was, I was talking to an American journalist named Steve Call, who was the editor of the Washington Post and is now a writer at the New Yorker, and he was talking about a party that he went to in Silicon Valley. This is maybe 8 or 9 years ago, and he was saying that during this party, they were sort of hanging out the back on the porch or whatever, and he was with a bunch of kind of young, very wealthy entrepreneurs, two of whom were the founders of Google. Mm-hmm. And at this point, they would have been, you know, still in their 30s, but would have made like vast amounts of money. And he asked them, "So what's next for you guys? Like, you're young, you're still young, you've made all this money. What are you going to do next?" And one of them, I can't remember which one it was, said, "Well, the next big thing is we're going to try and solve death."
And so that solve death.
Okay,
that was their second.
Yeah. Yeah. And so Google have subsequently started this company called Calico, which is a biotech research firm, which is explicitly aimed at finding biotech solutions to aging.
To death. Aging. First aging and then death.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, it's like, it is, you know, it can seem like a very extreme kind of group of whack jobs, but some of those whack jobs are extremely influential and powerful and wealthy people.
And for you, Martijn, how would you...
To some extent, I think we are all transhumanists in the sense that we are not just natural biological beings, but we wear clothes and we have roofs above our heads and some of them of us have even glasses or pacemakers within our bodies. So all of us, we all have escaped from our natural conditions, so to say. Uh-huh. And I think the transhumanists only extrapolate this idea that somehow we are disconnected from nature and we have to conquer the natural fate. And they extrapolate it even that we have to conquer death. But to some extent, we all dislike death and try to expand our lifetime, etc. And some of us take vitamin pills every day. And then Ray Kurzweil, one of those well-known transhumanists, he takes 200 pills. But there's only a gradual difference.
It's a spectrum, right? It's a continuum. Yeah.
Okay, so we're all transhumanists, but the ones you write about are like the most extreme part of it.
Yeah, for sure. But I think that's a really important point. And in a way, that was like the genesis of my interest in this topic, is that like I never wanted to write about these people who were completely other and who were just sort of freakishly different and, you know, extreme. What really interested me was exactly as you say. I mean, the book for me came out of this moment when I write about it in the first chapter where, you know, I had a child, I became a parent for the first time, and I, along with all the other like really wonderful aspects of becoming a father for the first time, I also got really preoccupied by death. I don't know whether this is probably relatively normal, but any kind of major life sort of transition that I have, I always wind up becoming preoccupied by mortality. And so I became fascinated by transhumanism at that time as a movement that, like, instead of just sitting around having existential philosophical thoughts about the fact that we're all mortal. Like, these people wanted to roll up their sleeves and invest money and ingenuity and science.
So would you say that you admire them in a sense?
No, I wouldn't. It's not that simple. I mean, in some way, I do. Like, I do admire, like, the Promethean kind of urge. I think, like, so there's a distinction, I think, between me as a person and me as a writer. As a writer, I'm fascinated by people who have these kind of Promethean projects. As a person, I'm slightly repelled by it, but there is an element of admiration, like, contained within that.
What repels you?
The idea of, like, well, the prospect of living forever personally is deeply unappealing to me. But at the same time, the idea of dying is equally, if not more, unappealing. So, I mean, that's part of what I'm trying to do in the book, is sort of play with that paradox and investigate it to some extent. But I think there is a core of identification. Like, as you say, we are all transhumanists to some extent. Nobody wants to die tomorrow, you know? And if you talk to, like, early on when I was writing the book, I had a conversation with my dad about it, and my dad is like 74 now, but at the time he was probably 70, and he said, well, maybe you'll feel differently about it when you get to my age, because, you know...
Does he feel different than you because he's older?
He doesn't want to live forever, but he also doesn't want to...
A bit longer.
Yeah.
Every time,
yeah.
A bit longer than you have.
Yeah, and no one wants to die. Like,
no?
I think people are comforted by mortality in the abstract, but I think when it gets to the moment, very few people actually want to die themselves right there at that point. So there is, like, it's a complicated, and it's a deeply human topic. It's, you know, it's all this stuff is about things that we all think about and we all go through and all struggle with, I think.
Yeah. And your question is of whether technology can help us in this sense. So, yeah. But.
Maybe we will ask the third speaker on stage, Hannah Barefoot, one of the most successful and prolific writers of her generation, and she so far published 7 novels, and the last 3 of her novels have taken a speculative turn. One novel, After, has a medicine against the symptoms of falling in love. Another one, Ivanov, has 2 ambitious and morally very ambiguous scientists. And her last book, Fizzy, deals with affection for machines. And she will read a fragment from Ivanov.
Thank you. I'm going to read a little piece from the Ivanov novel. It's about a scientist, Helena Frank, who wants to crossbreed apes, chimpanzees, with human beings to create an entire new species. And in this part, a young journalist, Felix, asks the scientist if this is ethically okay. And it's going to be in Dutch, but there'll be a translation, I heard. Ik vraag me alleen af of het ethisch gezien in orde is, vroeg ik. Aha, zei Helena, daar gaan we, ethiek. Is dat jouw kader, Felix? Het principe achter de manier waarop jij de wereld indeelt? Ethiek gaat inderdaad over goed en slecht, schrijft voor wat zwart is en wat wit, zodat we zelf niet meer van dichtbij hoeven te kijken. Niet te ver naar de deurknop hoeven te reiken, niet te hoog naar het lichtkoortje hoeven te grijpen. Maar ethiek is de taal van de machtige, Felix. Moraal slechts een verhaal dat de status quo handhaaft. En onveranderlijk blijft zolang de machtigste tevreden zijn. En heb ik het niet over de machthebbers. De machtigste kunnen ook een machteloze meerderheid zijn. Waar het om gaat is dat zij een set arbitraire regels voortbrengt. Zo zie ik het niet, zei ik. Ik volg toch geen regels? Is ook zo, zei Helena. Niemand neemt het woord regel graag in de mond wanneer het op ethiek aankomt. Regels starten autonomie en zelfbeschikking. Regels kun je breken bovendien. Dus hebben we het niet over regels, maar over vanzelfsprekendheden. Natuurlijke wetten waar we ons maar al te graag naar schikken. Zoals onze moeder zich naar de wetten uit de Bijbel, de Torah of de Koran schikte. Alles beter dan ons te laten verzwelgen door de chaos die ons leven in wezen vormgeeft. En hoe meer vrijheid we bezitten, hoe gehoorzamer we ons naar onze ongeschreven wetten plooien. Al was het alleen omdat onze eigen gehoorzaamheid ons het recht verschaft de wetten ook aan anderen op te leggen. Anderen die we immer gevaarlijker dan onszelf achten. Met ethiek houden we vooral hen in toom. Morele normen van nu zijn de fundamentalistische geloofsovertuigingen van ooit. Wie niet in God gelooft, zou ook ethiek moeten afwijzen, want net als religie is moraal zand in de wielen van de vooruitgang, ethiek het tegendeel van progressie. Het kan toch ook wel eens nut hebben, vroeg ik. Het is maar wat je nuttig acht, zei Helena. Die ethiek van jou houdt grenzen in stand, houdt hiërarchieën in stand, stelt de mens buiten de natuur en boven het dier. Een fictie, Felix. We staan nergens boven of buiten. We maken onderdeel uit van alles om ons heen en dat is beangstigend. Want als we niet aan de top van de keten staan, wat legitimeert onze macht dan? Zonder moraal hadden mens en aap zich al langzaam voortgeplant. Denk je dat echt, vroeg ik? Dat weet ik wel zeker, concludeerde Helena. Want het is mogelijk, Felix, en er is geen enkele reden om het niet te laten plaatsvinden. Er is slechts één reden om het wel te laten plaatsvinden, het redt levens. En zodra de machtigen dat inzien, zal de moraal van jou veranderen, Felix. Men zal begrijpen dat mijn onderzoek niet heel anders is dan het transplanteren van een varkenshartklep naar het lichaam van een vaatpatiënt of, zo je wil, het kweken van een nieuwe tomatensoort. Wat als Galileo, Darwin en Da Vinci zich hadden laten leiden door de arbitraire regels van hun tijdsgeest? We zouden hun namen niet gekend hebben.
Thank you, Hannah. We just heard a monologue by a scientist who is very arrogant, I would say, yeah. About what scientists are.
Later, yes, also.
Is it something you also see in this transhumanist movement, the idea that you're above nature or you have the right to decide about others and ethics?
Yeah, do they see ethics as like a repressive thing mostly, or do they think about it at all?
It's not like a major portion of the conversation around transhumanism. I think like the idea that like we need to take our evolution out of the hands of nature is really central to transhumanism. And there are, like, you know, the whole sort of field of bioethics is kind of seen as being somewhat restrictive when it comes to transhumanism, I think. And so there is a tension there for sure. But yeah, it's absolutely like we need to become masters of, we need to sort of remove ourselves finally from nature. And it's like you were saying at the beginning, there's always been this, like, it's fundamental to human nature that we want to remove ourselves from nature, and with mm-hmm. very good reason, because you know nature. You know, if nature runs its course, things are pretty miserable, actually. But the transhumanism is about like pushing this forward, like radically, and finally taking everything out of the hands of nature.
Well, I think you took a really great part of your novel to read, and it was exactly the part I had. With the thick lines,
wow. Wow.
underlined, because it's quite close to my own monster theory, and I would say it's exactly what happens all the time, that we shift our ethical categories, mm-hmm. and maybe it's the main result of new technology that we do such a thing.
But so we shift to adapt, or
yeah,
we
well,
shift to, for what
reason? How was she called, your
scientist?
Helena. What she says is, you call her arrogant, but somehow
I call her arrogant.
That's her.
We shift these ethical.
Yeah, but it's also what she says. She said like 100 years ago they would say it was a good idea. Yeah. Actually, 100 years ago people thought crossbreeding apes and human beings was a good idea. So she's kind of angry that nowadays we think differently. She says that's so arbitrary and repressive. Mm. And
so and we. Well, what happens all the time is that we think about nature or natural things as being objective facts. Mm-hmm. But to my mind, nature is much more, well, a category.
Yeah. It's
which
a
symbolic category, which all the time gets another meaning. Mm-hmm. And it might also be that all those transhumanist proposals of how we can enlarge and enhance ourselves mm-hmm. could also shift our idea of what it is to be a natural being or to die, maybe even to die. There, in my book is an example of the shift of the notion of death with connected to organ transplantation. Well, in the end of the 60s and start of the 70s, there was you know, a large debate about organ transplantation, and at that time you had to kill someone, the dying patient, to get off its heart or another organs to implant it in another body, and then you really killed someone until the notion of brain death was invented, more or less, which meant that a natural category, it was nature to die, got another meaning, a fundamental different meaning.
So this like in-between concept was needed to make organ transplantation possible, like ethically?
Yeah, yeah, in fact, history tells. That's true. But it means that it doesn't mean that current ethics isn't, we should get rid of it.
Yeah.
No, we shouldn't get rid of it. All the time we need these large discussions about what we
so maybe
allow
this is,
or not.
This is too much, or this is one way to talk about in concept, but there's of course also like a very concrete situation, for example, in transhumanism, that the main investors are tech bros or people who really made billions in the tech industry and want to live longer. Mm-hmm. What does it do with this transhuman ideology? I mean, is it deeply gendered in a sense?
In the very obvious sense that the vast majority of transhumanists are men.
Yeah, and you can follow them in your book.
Yeah,
visit them.
There's
one
woman,
isn't
there? Yeah, and she gets all the interviews.
Right. Yeah, there are three women in the book who I talk to about transhumanism. One of them runs an investment venture capital firm, which is again funded by Peter Thiel, and she's extremely young, extremely brilliant. Her name is Laura Deming. She's a woman.
She's doing research on the aging, the
deteriorating, and investing in various pharmaceuticals and therapies that might be useful for life extension and so on. So she runs a venture capital firm that's purely focused on life extension therapies. And then Natasha Vida Moore, who's the head of the World Transhumanist Institute, and there was a couple of other people who I talked to who didn't make it into the book, but basically, because there was a moment where I sort of thought, well, I need to represent women in this world, but then I kind of thought, well, why would I be doing that? I'm artificially, like, there's a certain point where you can represent people, but then you're kind of misrepresenting the broader movement itself, and it is overwhelmingly a sausage fest. I don't know if you have this.
These transhumanists, they want to attack this border between life and death, but do they attack the border between men and women, which is also a natural
I think not so much
border.
Because they are men, because we were just talking backstage how strange it is that women are not the front runners of this whole society, like the transhumanist group, because women have a lot to gain. We're the one with the uterus, the menopause, the menstruation. I would love to change bodies even if it's just for a while.
Yeah.
So in that way, it's funny that it's all male, but do you think that the discussion is not so much there because it's run by male and with the discussion about...
Well, Natasha Vida Moore as an example, again, like my sort of encounter with her in the book, she talked a lot about her own bodily issues, many of which had to do with like fertility and you know, her problems with her womb and so on. So that is an element that's there. But in general, like, gender is not a huge it's not a major aspect of transhumanism at all. I think largely because the sort of whole thing is predicated on moving beyond biology entirely. And so most of the transhumanists that I met, you know, some of them want to spend, you know, radically extended lives or even eternity in their own human bodies, but the vast majority of them actually want to be something other than human in the first place. So the problem is biology. The problem is having a body at all for a lot of these people.
How would they see? Well, one very interesting part of your book was about brain emulsion, the idea to just upload your brain to a thing, something else, maybe a tree or anything. But how would these transhumanists see themselves, not in terms of sex, but in terms of gender? Mm. Would they perceive themselves as male or female in that thing? Or how do you think their image would, their self-image would?
That's a really interesting question. And I'm tempted to answer it by saying that they don't see the post-human self as having a gender at all. But I also think that there is something uniquely or like peculiarly male about the fantasy of post-humanity that most of these people have, which is a very, like, rationalist kind of view of what it means to be human. And so, like, emotional complexity and nuance don't have that much role in their ideal vision of the future. And also, like, what it means to be human right now, the definition that they're operating on is very much, like, human value has to do with intelligence for these people. And they have a very, I don't mean to be too, like, narrow in terms of my definitions, but what I saw was that their view of what it means to be human is very narrow and based on intelligence, and also their view of intelligence is very narrow. It's essentially what a computer does.
Yeah.
And so there's, like, a lot of transhumanism arises out of this anxiety that our machines are getting really sophisticated and that we need to kind of merge with our machines and actually become machines if we're not going to be obsolete entirely. And so, like, I don't want to say that that's a peculiarly male kind of anxiety, but there is, like, I think there must be a reason why transhumanism is so overwhelmingly appealing to men rather than women.
So somehow they are scientifically very progressive, but normatively quite conservative. So this idea of intelligence is very much a very conservative idea of intelligence.
Transhumanism is ironically a really conservative.
So they don't reflect on their own normative assumptions.
Not that much. No.
Yeah. And so, so we're talking about this extension of life, be it with a body or without, because the whole brain is being uploaded into something else. But what I found really interesting is you were just saying that one of the ideas of this immortality is also to beat the machines, in a sense, to merge so that they won't take over humanity.
Yeah.
But so this is one motivation. But the other one is also what I thought, what are those consciousnesses are going to do with all this time? Because it's a lot about survival, but nothing what to do with all these eons, ages, I don't know how long.
And also without a body, because a lot of activity and also joy comes from
having a body or being a body.
In a way, this is where it becomes very close to being a kind of religious idea. Because the idea of, like, transcending the body and reaching this entirely different plane of existence, which is there's a notion that's called the singularity, which I write about in the book, and this is an idea that's really kind of the kind of endpoint of transhumanism in a way. And it's there's a writer called Ray Kurzweil, who some of you may have heard of, and he's director of engineering at Google, but he's also a kind of a fairly well-known inventor. He invented things like the flatbed scanner and Kurzweil organs, that's him as well. But he wrote this book called The Singularity Is Near, where he kind of outlines what it will mean to be, like, human post-singularity. And it's basically a disembodied existence. And his vision of what you do after this point is basically high-level computation. It's completely inhuman. It has no relationship to what.
It really sounds very enjoyable.
Yeah, and so it's almost like it's pure abstraction. It's like it's absolute abstraction at a level of, like, so it is kind of religious in a way. It's like, you know, the angelic sort of
also new age, I guess. We're going to this
like a next bodiless level.
Yeah.
Doesn't sound so.
It's deeply unappealing to the vast majority of people, and yet it's like a, you know, it's almost a religion in certain quarters of Silicon Valley, the idea of the singularity.
So more on a very practical level, would you want to be immortal given the choice? And you can either choose with or without body, I guess.
Oh, okay.
Because without it seems to make no sense.
Well, I think I'd be in team switch off. I think there's a lot of scientists.
What does it mean?
And yeah, well, I just made up the team, but it's a team I'd like to be in. There's a lot of scientists and thinkers who say maybe we can reach immortality, but we'll have to switch off ourselves at a certain age, so you stay healthy for a long time, and then you just switch off. And I think that's a practical thing, because if I'm immortal, probably a lot of other peoples are immortal, and then it will be very crowded. So I think you also should have the rule that when you're immortal, you should not have kids, or, like, not reproduce. So you're either immortal or not reproduce. Mm-hmm. But I would like to become old but healthy. So let's say 120, stay healthy till 110. So I have 10 years to kind of
you know, say goodbye to life and fun. That would be, yeah, my comfort, yeah. Point, I guess. What would you say?
I cannot directly answer that question, because as a philosopher, I would ask, what is immortality then? And well, because
a lot of time.
I think in history, this idea of immortality has been pictured all the time in a different way. So somehow, all cultures from the agricultural revolution on had this idea that we as humans are flawed, have a shortage, that we need shelter, etc. And then the idea of perfection was born as a dream. So the old Greeks, they dreamt of immortality by, you could only become immortal by doing immortal deeds, like Achilles in the Ilias in Troy.
Or writing a book.
And then, but he had to die quickly after, because else he wouldn't become immortal. Hmm. You became immortal by in the stories and by being...
By heroic deeds.
Yeah. And then after, the Christians found out that these stories would die out when cultures died, so the immortality was projected on the soul. We have an eternal soul. So the life on earth was, of course, a tranendal, we say, I don't know the English word, a place where you should suffer, but in the end we would become immortal in heaven. So, and it's only maybe the idea we think about immortality nowadays, which is somehow very much an individual immortality. Mm-hmm. It's really new in history, yeah, that we think about this as in the way we do.
So even immortality is a very contingent or like
related
to time.
It's interesting about all these technologies that it's all focused on the individual body. The individual should survive,
yeah,
not the group. We should not try to make a better society. But it's only, it's as if the individual is the only, the body is the only way we can grasp this perfection, and the rest of the other projects have failed, so now we try this. But I think it's a kind of that way in which we will, it's just an aberration, so to say, we will come back from that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I don't really know if I have an answer to the question. I think instinctively I want to say I'd like to live until I'm 94. That's the number I have in my head for some reason. That
94?
Seems like a good age, yeah. It's also my grandmother's age, and she seems like she's, you know, she's okay, but she's, you know, probably ready to go at this point, I think. And but so...
You ask her?
You know, I haven't asked her. We don't have okay. But I also think that, like, what you're saying is really true. Like, there's a disconnect or a conflict between, like, transhumanism is very focused on the individual, what's good for the individual. It's all about transhumanists overwhelmingly are focused on themselves and their own future. And the idea that the worst possible thing that can happen is the death of the individual, the death of oneself, is absolutely central to transhumanism. So I think, like, there's a real connection between, like a lot of transhumanists, like a lot of people in Silicon Valley, there's a strong strand of like libertarianism running through both Silicon Valley and transhumanism itself. It's a deeply individualist way of thinking about what it means to be human and way of thinking about like the future and values and so on. But there's a conflict between like the collective and the individual when it comes to talking about immortality, which is like really obvious. I mean, there's like overpopulation, obviously, yes, but if you don't die, you know, what happens to younger generations? And I think like dying is a public service on some level, you know? And I think we need to bear that in mind.
Maybe.
But I don't particularly want to die.
At 94.
Yeah, well, come back to me when I'm 92.
Okay,
talk
we will.
Again. Yeah.
So you already gave us like a historical overview of even thinking about immortality. But in another way, in your book, you show that this particular idea of immortality also comes from an idea of the mind being compared to a computer, mm-hmm, or being very comparable to. So I was wondering, are we humans only able to think of the human mind and consciousness by way of metaphors? And are these metaphors that also give us the options of how to think of the future? Or
immortality?
Well, I think so, because, well, if you have it, if you talk about the brain specifically, I think that system is way too complex to not describe in metaphors. Mm-hmm. But this also makes me think about an essay by Susan Sontag, Illness as a Metaphor. Mm-hmm. She wrote this in the 70s. She was diagnosed with breast cancer. And that whole essay is, a plea not to use metaphors when it comes to medical science, because the way cancer was described with metaphors back in the 70s was very negative. It was seen as an invasion. It was seen as something strange, something you had to fight. So she says using metaphors is a way of framing, so don't. But I would say, well, if it's such a powerful tool, can't we use it for the good, you know, to create understanding, but also to frame something possibly, positively, but I'm not sure if you should. So I don't think we can do without, but we definitely need to think about
it. Yeah, I mean, like, I think consciousness is unthinkable without metaphors in a weird sort of way. Like, historically, we've always, and I write about this a little bit in the book, like, we've always used the latest technology as the sort of presiding metaphor for ourselves, for our minds, like in, you know, the 18th century or whatever, it was, you know, water and sort of hydraulics, and then it became steam, and now it's the computer. So it's kind of, it's, I don't want to say natural, but it seems like obvious in a way that that is what we would do. But I don't know what it would mean not to use metaphors to think about consciousness. But I am also at the same time suspicious of how metaphors can seep into, like, they can seem to be something other than metaphors. Mm-hmm. And when people write about the mind as a machine, in a lot of cases, they literally mean the mind is a kind of computer, that what a human mind does and what a computer does are essentially the same kind of thing. And I think that's sort of slightly dangerous.
That's when it frames. Yeah. That's how they frame the mind being like a computer, while it's not, actually.
Yeah.
But why is it dangerous? Yeah. Because it's untrue, you would say.
Well, it's
the
just
mind
one
doesn't
part,
work.
Well, you write it beautifully in your book, how you're against that frame, the mind being a computer, because it's way too simple, it's way more complex, and you lose humanity in that frame.
Yeah.
You just use everything that says we're not a computer.
Maybe. Yeah, I guess I'm not against the metaphor, but I'm against the adoption of the metaphor as reality, which seems to be what's happening. And so if you say that the mind is a kind of computer, or the computer is a kind of mind, then the two things are interchangeable, and the human mind is replaceable by a machine in some way, which is a fantasy, but it's also like we live on fantasies, you know? Like reality is based on certain fantasies.
It's how
but
you
understand. The metaphor might be dangerous, but isn't it at the same time kind of mirror for us to discover who we are?
Mm.
So at a certain point of time, we will find out that our mind isn't a machine.
But it will be the other latest technology.
I think we do, and even technology learns us that it's not. Yeah, maybe it's the well-known example of the chess machine.
Mm.
First, we thought when the chess machine won from the world
from
champion,
human.
How was it called?
Kasparov.
Then that the computer was better than we were. But then people started to think, and well, no, it's different. What the chess machine is doing is not thinking. Thinking is something different.
Yeah.
So that's where the machine started to become a mirror to us,
to rethink
what thinking or what mind is about. So when we stay reflexive, it's not dangerous, it's just...
But I also think it's really interesting in revealing that, so you mentioned the, you know, it was a deep mind or whatever, what was the name of the computer that defeated Kasparov? But so before that point, it was always seen that like we will have achieved artificial intelligence once a machine can beat the greatest human chess player at chess. And then that happens, and we realize, oh, that's just like a level on the way to artificial intelligence. But also, it's really interesting.
We realize, or we just redefine what then human is.
Yeah, I think that's part of it. Yeah, for sure. But also, like game playing is always the sort of the level that artificial intelligence is required to reach. It's always games. So at the moment, it's like, is it AlphaGo? I think is the
next
game.
Challenge
you know, it's always sort of like adversarial. And like winning or losing. And that's the sort of way that we measure, or the way that people who are interested in artificial intelligence measure whether machines have reached human level or whatever. And, you know, there are much more complicated and important things than games.
maybe to another question is, does it even make sense to think of immortality on a dying Earth? So why think about whether our consciousness or bodies could be still here in 200 years if maybe the Earth is inhabitable or not not here in for humans at least in 100 years? Or
yeah, I think it's not contradictionary to think. I think it's the same thing, you know, wondering how we as human could live on it without the Earth, without the bodily form, is the same as thinking, oh, what are we going to do when the Earth ends? So I think it's not different.
Like the, uploading this brain in another material.
I think all these transhumanists and also like this techno-utopist, they think technology will either save the Earth, so we can just stay here, or technology will help us to leave the Earth when it goes down, I think.
Yeah.
To get in space.
Yeah. I mean, I'm thinking immediately of Elon Musk, who is always kind of coming out with these apocalyptic visions of the future of humanity. And one of his big kind of drums that he's continually banging is to do with artificial intelligence. And AI is, in his view, and this is a fairly standard transhumanist view, actually, is getting so sophisticated that we're going to become obsolete as a species, which is kind of a version of what I've just been saying, actually.
It's really interesting, these figures, you know, like Elon Musk, but Bill Gates has the same kind of prose. They really compare to, resemble the Frankensteinian myth, or even Frankenstein in the myth of Frankenstein. We have a film later on this evening. But in it, you see that at first Frankenstein has this utopian idea of being in control over life.
Yeah. Defeating death,
As soon as this creation was born or coming alive, then he becomes very fearful, he becomes frightened. So he shifts from the utopian thought to the dystopian thought. Yeah. And this is the same which happens in the prose of Elon Musk, who warns us.
So first it's living very long and then it's escaping
but
Earth.
In both ways of thinking, we think they are opposites. But somehow they're connected because in both ways of thinking, they disconnect from their relation with technology. From a neutral instrument, it gets a natural force coming over us. Yeah. But then our human choice to steer technology, it gets lost somehow.
That's really true, and
I would say they depoliticize it.
Yeah, human agency becomes, like, takes a backseat, definitely. And there's also, like, this is really strong binary kind of view of the prospects for technology. Either it destroys us, artificial intelligence becomes, like, gets to a superhuman level and, starts to have its own projects and winds up destroying us, sort of Terminator style, or it saves us from ourselves and becomes this, like, godlike intervention. Yeah. There's never any sense that we might use it for it, like, you know, that we might be able to control it and, like, use it for, like, our own ends. And I think there's, like, a really strange sort of inability to see that these things are actually subject to choice and control right now. Like, if we think artificial intelligence is going to destroy us, we don't have to build it. But there is this sense of, like, technological determinism that you get with these people like Elon Musk, that it has its own logic and it's going to play itself out, and we just have to sort of hope for the best and try and control it, like, along the way, but we can't stop it.
Does it, or you would say we could still intervene in any way?
Well, I'm sort of, I don't know how, like, relevant this is, but I'm quite skeptical that artificial intelligence is going to be this, like, radically transformative thing. We tend to talk about artificial intelligence in a way that we take the lead from people like Elon Musk, and we think of it as this, like, kind of huge, like, transformative thing that's going to happen in the future, and which that kind of elides the extent to which it's already sort of influencing our lives in ways that are much more mundane, but still quite sort of worrying in a way. Like, you know, artificial intelligence does sort of have a role in the everyday person's life. It's just like things like, you know, YouTube recommendation algorithms and, you know, GPS and all these kinds of things.
So it's already there. But does that make any difference in how far we could intervene or have any democratic control a citizen over it? Or
well, I think there is a danger. It's not the danger in the metaphors, but there's a danger in this way of thinking, depoliticizing technology, as if it's not a human project with all kinds of choices all the time. And because then it's technology, it's only for experts, so to say. They know, and we as laymen and citizens, we do not know. And
we simply do not know how.
We will just be confronted as users with the results of the experts. But do we know
how our smartphones work, even though we watch it like 80% of the time? Or
I certainly don't.
That's a result of this.
But you still think there is a way to intervene, even if you don't know how it works or have any say?
Well, I think as users or as normal citizens, not being high-tech experts, we somehow, I think, have a duty to know. We should know.
How?
Well, by being involved.
Watching YouTube videos.
But you don't need to be an engineer. But on the other hand, experts should, from a very early stage, involve other stakeholders and not just the planned user, but also the ones who are disadvantaged by these technologies to design it. And in this transhumanist thinking, or also in robotics, it's very technology driven. So often the normative questions aren't asked in front of the development, but only afterwards, then the ethicists come responding to these science fiction scenarios.
Should we ask them, or how should we ask these questions before we're just presented with something as a consumer?
Yeah, well, I think like, the book that I wrote is actually saturated with this anxiety about the future of technology, and particularly artificial intelligence. And when I was writing the book, like, the one kind of like catastrophic scenario that I was kind of persuaded by was not that artificial intelligence is going to go like Terminator on us and destroy us, but that, you know, jobs are going to be like
substituted,
just automated.
Over. Yeah,
and
the robots are coming.
But yeah, so like, and since I've written the book, I've started to wonder whether like who does that narrative serve? You know, if we all believe that our jobs are contingent on, you know, us being allowed to do them, and that anything we do is replaceable by a machine, what does that do to us? You know, it sort of disempowers us in a way. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. It sounds kind of conspiracy theory-ish, but I wonder whether that narrative just keeps us meek in some way. You know,
isn't it rhetorics, pure rhetorics? This scenario that the robots are coming and take our jobs.
Yeah. Yeah, I think sit down and shut up and like don't unionize because the robots are going to come anyway.
Yeah, it's to my mind it's very much the dystopian way of thinking about technology, that it is a natural force. They are coming.
Yeah.
We don't have a choice. We can only adopt a bit toward that condition.
Yeah. So we have to wrap up.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
So we shouldn't rise up against the robot, but just think about what we do want to do and not be afraid that the robot will take us over.
Well, it strikes me that all of this is actually a metaphor for capitalism. Actually.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. That was like the ending.
Yeah.
All of this is actually a metaphor for capitalism.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Martijntje Smit, Frank O'Connell, and Mark. Sorry.
Yes.
Mark
O'Connell. I'll take
Frank.
That's a cool name.
And Hannah Werfoots. Yeah. I don't know where the Frank was coming from.